While technology enhances teaching in a variety of ways, the truly transformative experience of digital learning occurs when teachers combine technology with project-based instruction. No school has made a greater commitment to project-based learning or had greater success than Manor New Tech High.
Project-based learning is a pedagogical shift in delivery of instruction. No longer is the teacher in the front of the classroom pushing information out to the students. What happens now is a teacher designs and creates projects using the state standards, and most of our classes are integrated. So all of our humanities, social studies, and language arts are team taught. If they're team taught class, we take the standards in English language arts, the standards in social studies, they put them together to create a project based upon our scope and sequence in the district. When you see the depth of the projects, you really see there is learning going on to a level that's equivalent to AP. Oftentimes we wish our name wasn't Manor New Technology. Technology wasn't in the name, because that gives a misconception that because of the technology, that's why we're successful. And reality is, for us, the technology is the invisible tool. The technology isn't what makes a school, it's project-based instruction. However, the technology is integrated throughout the courses.
I think it's great because it offers so many different possibilities as to how they can deliver what they've learned.
And project-based learning is a very important, critical component for us so that teachers use projects as a way to teach content throughout the whole course. And the key to that, of course, is making sure that teachers know what that is. And so we do have a very rigorous 4-day training institute that we are now cycling our teachers through so that they understand what that is. And then when they come back into the classroom, they are practicing those particular skills.
Think Forward is a project-based learning institute. It's a 4-day-long institute in which actual practitioners in the classroom, so Manor and New Technology teachers, we've developed modules to show really 6 essential elements to project-based learning.
So we picked teachers that were good at certain systems, and we had them write the components of the systems that we feel that are important for project-based instruction.
And so what we do is we bring in teachers, and we started out with 7 elementary school teachers from Manor ISD and 4 middle school teachers from Manor.
See how it zoomed in from something that was itty-bitty and made it big?
I didn't have any hesitation about it. I like to do new things, and I don't mind being the first to do something. I like challenges, and it seemed a good way to change the mode of the classroom and the mode of learning. And I've read about project-based learning, and when she asked me if I wanted to do it, I went and did research on it, and I just became excited about being able to bring a new approach to learning back to the kids.
We took them through 4 days of these 6 elements, and we would teach them the critical attributes of each element and then give them time to develop their own project with that.
I had a previous lesson I'd done with the class, and it was from a math website, and it was building a playhouse. Okay, and so from the idea of building a playhouse, and we started with, this is 4th graders, and we were going to do popsicle sticks and all of that, but then as we got deeper into the training, we felt, okay, this can be more sophisticated, even though they're 4th graders. So we kind of kicked it up to designing a house. And then we thought of, doing the blueprint. But then someone mentioned, well, there's Google Sketch, so they could do a 3D model. And so as the week went on, it just kept getting more and more sophisticated.
For the Manor teachers at the end of the four days, then they return back to their home campuses, and they're expected to implement a project pretty quickly after that.
I am going to serve as a mentor and a resource to the teachers that are coming into the project. In fact, we've been doing that the past 2 weeks. We've been just kind of going, because we're all in the same wing, and so we can interact with each other, and we've just been doing that constantly.
I've got practitioners who are doing it daily, teaching other teachers the successes, the struggles, the strategies, the nuances of how to create a really good project that has depth to them. And the feedback we've gotten so far from the cohorts that have been through has been very good.
One of the major advantages of project-based learning combined with technology is that it empowers teachers to build lessons around state standards that are creative, engaging, and meaningful to students.
When I talk about the kids learning area and perimeter, that's part of what the state standards say that fourth graders should learn. So everything, every lesson plan that we do is based on the standards that the kids must learn. They had to also say, what's the perimeter of each room, what's the area in each room, and then what's the perimeter and the area of the total drawing that they've designed. We looked at the Habitat for Humanity website and saw different designs of houses. And we, of course, looked at examples of blueprints. I had an architect talk about what it means to design a house.
Remember what Mr. Segura taught us about your design methods, and I think, what kind of method are we all using on our houses?
It was just a matter of providing that scaffolding for them, that support, to give them the background knowledge they needed to move forward.
Look back at your PBL, look at the entry document, and it says, 3-bedroom, 2-bath.
The website that we used in completing the project and in using the 3D shapes was one that's dedicated to Frank Lloyd Wright. And its whole premise is letting students design houses in 3D form, and where they go through all of the steps of having a client.
So that when you pick your client, then they're describing to you what they want in the house.
And picking out where they're going to build the house, what style of house they're going to have, what's the height of the house, what's the roof going to look like, where am I going to put my bedrooms, where am I going to put my bathrooms. And so the kids use the technology, I think, quite capably.
Oftentimes at the end of our projects, when students put together their end product, it's usually presented to an external panel, not to the teacher and not to the class. We'll have parents come sit on panel. We'll have experts, whatever that project's on, to come in and sit on the panel. And then the students are presenting to experts, not to the class. And what you find is that it takes on a whole different meaning.
I think for the kids, it just validated what they were doing. You know, it wasn't like, oh, there's going to be an architect here. How do we handle this? It just validated to them that what we've done is so important that an architect is going to come and listen to us present it.
I was kind of proud because she was hearing me, and I didn't thought an architect could be hearing at me. And, you know, I felt proud of myself.
I felt a little bit nervous because it was kind of our first time. But we also practiced a lot, and we got through it together as a team.
For me, it was nervous because we needed to come, like, with professional clothing, and I needed to wear a tie, so I was nervous because I thought, like, people would make fun of me, but...
Did that happen? Did anybody make fun of you?
No.
What did they think when they saw you with a tie on at school? What did people say to you?
I had a lot of compliments.
Hey, I'm
elegant.
Yes. Collaboration is one of our learning outcomes, and they always have to work in collaboration. Our students work always in groups of 2 to 3, 3 to 4, and in that group, when they come together, they draw up a contract, what their roles are within that group. And they hold themselves accountable to that group, because you can be fired from the group, just like in a professional model.
And one of the things with having group members, when you wake up in the morning and you might not feel like going to school, you have that obligation to group members. You're like, I have to go to school because I can't just leave my group out there. So you actually, it gives you motivation to come. And then while you're here, you're having fun because you're on computers, you're building things. And while you're doing that, you're actually learning something.
Yeah. This school has a 0% dropout rate. These kids want to come to school. The school administrators and teachers hold them accountable for coming to school. But their peers hold them accountable. They work on projects together. If somebody's not there, their peers call them and say, hey, why aren't you here? You know, if you ask a high school dropout why he or she stopped coming to school, you overwhelmingly hear things like, well, nobody knew if I was there anyway. Nobody cared if I came to school. So these kids, knowing that somebody cares if they're there or not, they come to school every day.